Welcome back, everybody, here to the joinDOTA studio. I'm Toby One.
And I'm the Capitalist.
And we are here to give you not the final game of today, it's the final game of the I-League for today. If you want to stick around, we have the MSI Beat It qualifiers for a unknown region. We're doing the APAC qualifiers, or Middle Eastern qualifiers, for today. So if you want to stick around after this game, you can do so. We got more direction coming your way. But for this game, we have Navi US going up against a team which I thought, maybe it might just be a bunch of randoms, but it's not, Cap.
It's not. It's not randoms at all. In fact, I know these guys better than I knew the last team.
It's quite potentially Navi US could lose this game.
Potential.
I'm saying potential because
more potential than last. More potential than probably many of the best of 32.
How many times would you go round of 32 open qualifier matchup? Navi US is playing a team would beat like a team like Navi US.
Yeah. I mean, they're one of the favorites to at least make it to the finals. So
yeah,
it would be quite the shock. But I think this is going to be an excellent match. So for those of you guys who don't know. This team, they call it the Power of Friendship. It's led by Mario. Now, many of you guys don't know that name. Mario was actually the coach for Team Liquid. A lot of people didn't know this because he filled a similar role to Clairvoyance,
If they were really good, they would have actually watched the interviews with all the team coaches and managers, which Zoe did at TI4. If you were really good, you would have seen that.
So if you want to go over and look at that, maybe during a slower part of the game, if you just want to hop over to joindota.com/joindota+ and find that, you can see what Mario looks like and get his inputs on what coaching means and everything else. But Mario is a good player, but he's very similar to Clairvoyance, that maybe execution isn't as high enough to be a professional player, but he does have some great ideas about Dota. I've actually butted heads with him quite a bit about Dota back in the day when I used to actually play with these guys or play against these guys quite a bit. Me and him would butt heads about certain Dota concepts and that sort of thing. You also have Way Too Sexy, who should be a known name to everybody. Infinity is another North American player that a lot of if you're from the North American scene, you should know him. The fourth player is a player named MJW, who I don't actually know, but he's going by Degenerate, apparently. The last one, I'm interested to see how many of you guys, I mean, you're talking about old school names, Toby, and you're talking about Stars Boba. That is a bit more old school than this one. But Mr. Swish is a old school Filipino player who used to play not only Dota 1, but as well as he was a Heroes of New Earth pro. He has bounced back and forth between being a part of the Southeast Asian scene and being part of the North American scene. You'll sometimes see him come over and play with some of the North American guys, and he's going to be playing apparently with these guys. So I'm interested to see his return.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, he used to play. You are a mine of information right now.
I know the North American scene a bit better than. I know the amateurs of North American scene a lot better because they're my friends. So, but Mr. Swish used to play for Mineski as well as Duskbin back in the day.
Okay, so cool. Yeah, I know both those names very, very well.
So
Navi, I hate you but love you. This is exactly what they did yesterday. I say yesterday. They actually played their round of 64 match 2 days ago. It looks like, too, I'm going to DC out for a moment for some unknown reason.
Yeah, just random DC.
Yeah.
Thanks, Dota 2 servers.
I'm
not bitter at all that I may have died last night because I just randomly got DC'd because of Dota 2 servers last night.
Just randomly? That's for some.
Cost me a kill and got me killed. Great.
You're a poor man. Yeah, but you've got Skywrath as well as Faces of Void. We said it then, we'll say it now. TI4 combos! Things aren't changing. And now we actually go with a Pugna as well. Okay, this could get really, really painful right now. Really, really now painful for Power of Friendship.
Yeah.
Because you've got so much pushing power early on. You got insane lane harassment as well. You got the ability to silence and keep him at bay from very long range. Because technically you got like a double slow with concussive shot as well as decrepify. Not to mention the double amplifier, which you're getting out from both Skywrath as well as Pugna. And then you get big team fight controller, which is Faceless Void, which still synergizes with the Skywrath mage. And also with Pugna, be it the Nether Blast to hit the entire area of the Chrono, or one hero in one position having to stay there and be having his life points drained by the Pugna. So they got already great focus with just three heroes, and they still have another support hero and another off, or maybe off lane Faceless Void could do that, and another core hero to select for Na'Vi US, as if they're not running Skywrath as the core, because they did do that as well in their game.
Skywrath core is legit. He is an amazing mid. There's a reason that that one European public player, W33, I'm not sure what people actually call him, but there's a reason he runs so much Skywrath in the mid. It's a very, he's a lane dominator, first of all. I mean, if you thought Skywrath Mage was obnoxious as a support up against solo offlaners, being able to just constantly output damage against them over and over again, the mid Skywrath Mage is even worse. You pick up your level 6 very early on. You can burst down pretty much anybody with the proper execution. That shouldn't be a problem. So I think Skywrath Mage as a core is legit, but I'm not so sure they're going to be running it here. I think it would leave them pretty exposed to it'd be a lot of squishy heroes on their side, with the Skywrath mid and the Pugna taking over the one position. But we'll see what they do. If they do combine the Decrepify with the Skywrath Mage ultimate, though, no matter what support or core, that's still a dead hero. So
yeah. I don't see Nature's Prophet surviving in any of these engagements. I don't see Shadow Shaman or Earthshaker life points are not surviving through these engagements. I'm feeling very... I'm worried we're going to have a game very similar to the one that VP played yesterday.
Reserve time. That's so.
That's my major concern right now, because I just see this lineup snowballing from Na'Vi US.
Yeah.
I see it fully snowballing.
It won't be as bad as the Virtus Pro game, because there was a large discrepancy of skill and draft. Here, I don't think there's going to be as much of a discrepancy in skill.
Man, with a Wraith King pickup as well.
Yeah, that's so much single target nuking power
now. If they want it, okay, let's just consider the potential of running Skywrath, Wraith King, plus one aggressive offlane. Especially when you're going up against a Medusa. You're going up against a Medusa. She takes forever to be useful. And even then, she's not useful.
You what, mate? I don't even know how to respond to Medusa.
Cap. Well, that wonderful insight. You know these boys better than anybody else here in Steam.
Okay, so
why would you go Medusa in a lineup where you're going to get silenced and completely crippled? Like, her shield would have to evaporate with the amount of damage that Na'Vi US is going to be throwing at her.
There have been Medusa games that I have watched, that I have played, that I think Medusa maybe gets... shit on a bit too much for being a hero that can do nothing until 70 minutes.
I would sit there and go, you got a little bit of damage output, you got ability to protect yourself, not anybody else. You've got Stone Case, which is like, you have to be stupid to get caught by that.
You remember,
you just force like a fake disengage and then you come back in again.
Yeah, you remember the Hani mid Medusa? I'm not sure if you got an opportunity to cast that game. It might have been just...
I might have cast it, but I probably don't remember it.
Okay,
but enlighten me, Cap. Enlighten me.
So I think there are certain ways to build Medusa, both skill-wise and item-wise, that actually allow her to do a lot more than people malign her with. I think she is actually a pretty scary hero at 20 to 25 minutes. It takes you building into some fairly early damage. Hey, no. This one makes sense, man. Look at all the magic damage.
I just love, though, the fact you can have a game with two heroes that most people would just say, I never want to play these guys. Like, there was... even in the TI4 videos that came out from... who's that guy from New Zealand that does those awesome, like, all random... Yeah, him.
Yeah.
And he had just the image of Huskar sitting down there. It's like, you called to the stage! And Huskar's just there going, I'll never be a contender.
Yep.
Then we get Huskar and Medusa in the same game.
So, Huskar, I can get behind to a point here. I think Huskar can be legit. I think he can be legit. Okay. But he does belong in the fifth pick slot.
Yes.
He does have to be a surprise pickup. And it's against a team that is primarily magic damage dealers. And that is what Navi US are, excluding the Faces Void. Faces Void is really good versus Huskar because he's straight physical damage mixed in with an amazing controlling ability.
Of course, because he controls him when he's in the lowest point of his life point, so he can't actually make the most of like the blood. It's
yeah, you can't make the most use of your attack speed. So what is going to happen here is that while Huskar would have been a great pickup against every single one of the members of Navi US except for the orange player, it would have been great. The problem what's going to happen here is that Faces Void is going to jump in, Chronosphere, the Huskar. Okay. In these sort of scenarios, remember the magic damage reduction only works when you get low health. So even though Faces Void is going to be an offlaner, what's going to happen, he jumps in, Chronosphere, they're going to drop some bombs on Huskar. He's going to drop very, very low, very, very quickly. And he's going to get about to 30% and start taking less and less damage because that magic armor is really beginning to kick in. Except for the problem that if Face of Void has enough farm, say he has a Mask of Madness. Mm-hmm. Let's go for a Mask of Madness this game. Maybe we'll see it. It's not as popular for an offlane Void, but we'll see. If he gets a Mask of Madness, he could just finish off the Huskar, right, with all his physical damage.
Yeah.
So even though the Huskar will become to a point where he's like, I'm invulnerable versus all this magic damage, it's like, well, you're also low enough that his Void, even if he isn't massively farmed, can still just take you out real quickly. Yeah. So Huskar is interesting. This looks like it is going to be a mid-Medusa if he's fed some regen here. He should be being fed some regen. He went for the Wraith Band, two Iron Branches. So this is the build I want to see. I want to see like early Wraith Bands. I want to see Phase Boots, maybe a quick set of drums for some extra movement speed. I think that's the way you want to build Medusa, as much physical damage as early on as possible. And don't forget the power of Stone Gaze. Stone Gaze is pretty damn exceptional.
It doesn't
have the most amazing synergy with their team, though.
Because I never really feel the power of Stone Gaze when it comes to team fights. I'm like, oh, yeah. Stone Gaze! Yeah, Stone Gaze.
Most of the time, it's because teams just don't have the physical damage to be able to take advantage of it. They have Serpent Warts, which is an amazing source of physical damage, but that's a fairly hard combo to execute. They have the Furion, who's a lot of right-click damage, and the Huskar, who's about 30% physical damage, right? Most of your damage is coming from your Burning Spears, not your right-clicks.
Well, man, we have a Kornix Assassin. I better say a Kornix Assassin on the offlane, but it looks like he's rotated all the way down. So Korok is going to head down towards, well, what I would have assumed just to be mid is where I thought he'd go. And that's, yeah, it's in fact exactly where he's going. So we have Nyx versus Dusa in mid. Mm-hmm. We have Sneaking as the face of Void on bottom lane. Now, there was a rotation coming down from both Fogged as well as 1437, but they kind of like butted heads on the trees and then just one turned around. So 1437 is going to head north to come up here and combine up with Brax. And then that's going to leave Snaking as well as the Skywrath on the offlane. Now, Skywrath will have a great time up against Nature's Prophet. Then we go towards like middle lane Affinity. Like, okay, Medusa, I will reserve judgment until later. But yeah. Don't be surprised if I don't get excited about Stone Gaze or if I take it satirically in vain.
It's okay. There's a reason she wasn't picked up during TI.
But with Shadow Shaman as well as Earthshaker on the top lane, this top lane looks like it should be quite okay, but...
Well, it's a solo offlane Pugna. It doesn't really get... It's solo offlane Pugna with no boots, by the way.
He's not solo, though, because 1437 looks like he's hovering around
they
to
are.
Join him.
Okay,
so it's a dual offlane. It's a dual offlane.
Oh, it's a dual offlane?
I thought that they would have put something like the Wraith King on the bottom lane, however, and put the Skywrath on the top, because Skywrath could at least influence the Earthshaker and the Shadow Shaman a little bit more.
Yeah, Wraith King's
like
a nice...
Hellfire Blast would.
Yeah.
Because that's all it is, just one stun, that's it.
Yeah. Wraith King's a nice frontline hero, though. He's decently tanky. Maybe that's their thought process. But yeah, okay. I'm down with dual lanes. I'm down with an aggro try. Either way, Navi US want to run this. Think they probably could pull it off. It's dangerous versus a Huskar, though, to go an aggressive tri lane. I'll just put it at that. It's like they can execute it and pick off the supports. At the same time, if they overextend themselves, they're going to get punished quite heavily.
Yeah. Well, into the lanes we go. So Korok, we'll notice that he's up against Medusa in the middle lane. I'm wondering if he was considering just having something different there, but either way, Skyred's going to come in and Fogged. Well, this is how they want to set up a Kiss Medusa. You want to go early Wraithband? We'll just send the Skywrath in and he'll harass you out of lane with just an Arcane Bolt. Force you to burn through your early consumables, and because they're two shared tankos, he can't do anything about it. Like, he can't just go for another one. Oh, that's nice vision block. This could be a big problem right now for Fogged. He's going to run himself away from this one. Attempted body block, not going to work. Korok actually having to level up Stun to keep Infinity away, and well, yeah, he has it, but he never triggered it.
I think Infinity was trying to look for an opening where he could use the Mystic Snake on creeps, because he knew the Mystic Snake directly put on the Skywrath Mage would not kill him. He needed it to bounce a couple times and then hit the Skywrath, but...
Way too safe to go completely zoned down the top lane with just one Hellfire Blast and a Pugna Blast before that. Everything else was base damage. Now the Fissure movement, and they got Brax in a corner again. This rotation's been really damn good by them. One last blast is all Brax can do. He's going to give away First Blood.
Mr.
It goes
Swish.
To the Earthshaker.
This guy, man, that's two different Earthshaker blocks. I mean, the first one was very simple because the Skywrath Mage didn't know he was there, but still. Good rotations by him.
Now bottom lane, they're going to go on Nature's Prophet. There's no seal. They can't stop the TP out. And with no level up, actually, he has a level up in Time Lock, but Snaking was unable to get the hit off. Yeah. Or at least the lock hit off.
Also, I'm more concerned about this Huskar at one position because of the Faces Void not being run as an offlane, but as a core. As a one, sorry. So he means he will have Mask of Madness. He will have enough physical damage to threaten the Huskar. And Huskar is tanky because of his magic damage resistance, but he starts
top
out
lane
with no armor.
You want to check this one out right now. Earthshaker, it's going to happen again. I don't know if he can lock him in, however, but 1-4-3-7, slightly out of position. He needs to move up a little bit further this direction for the Fissure block to actually work.
Well, he can go for a Fissure block right here.
And there she goes. And 1-4-3-7 shackles. Probably not really required at this point, but 1-4-3-7 turns around for a stun. Nothing's going to come of it, though. And now it's 2-0. Wraith King goes down the top lane. So both heroes in the dual offlane of Na'Vi US have gone down.
Things are going surprisingly well for
their
experience. Power of Friendship.
Their gold is looking good. You keep looking at Moto.
These teams, like, what is? Come on now. Mercy. Mercy on the poor casters. You created a team name that we're saying for the first time.
As like officially put into the grid as well. So this is what you'll be flagged on all websites as well as VOD entries. But it's just like, it's Hello Moto is all I read when I read their name.
Which stands for Mario on the one, but Mario's a support player, so that must be some sort of joke.
Because he's never on the one. Oh, nice aggressive observer ward. Brax is going to have a real rough time now. I'm almost wondering if it's worthwhile rotating the Void up towards the top lane once he cracks level 6. I know you want to see the Mask of Madness over on Snaking, but at the same time, they need Brax to find levels and farm, and more importantly, they need Brax to force out that bottom tier 1 tower and get some kind of reaction from Moto. Damn you! Power of Friendship!
There it is. Just think...
Poff.
Yeah.
I think Poff.
Sure.
They call him Poff. Like profiteroles, but Poff.
We're going to have Na'Vi smoking up and making a rotation with their supports. They're setting out the bait for a rune. They're expecting one of the supports to come check the 4-minute rune. Unfortunately, Mario either knew or he was just lucky, but he backed away. Yeah. He didn't actually go for the rune check, so he must have known somehow.
Well, there's a lot of rotation coming up towards the top now. He doesn't know because Brax is right behind him. He'll go for the blast. The Hellfire Blast will now fly out after he got the Crippified, which instantly cancels the Shackles. And then with Skywrath Mage following up, Mario will go down. And way too sexy, running himself away. The blast will also connect, but we've got orbs, concussive shots. They're Fissure. She's going to push 1-4-3-7 back. So a lot of damage on him to Crippify, saving him from the right clicks of the Degenerate. And now Shaker, well, there's no follow-up. So he's just trying to beat down on top of 1-4-3-7, but they have enough damage. Degenerate is able to get the last hit on that one, but they bring four heroes to defend on this lane. This is not what you want to be doing if you're Power of Friendship, because it's left the Faces Void completely open on that bottom lane.
Yeah, it's not bad, though. Degenerate is still picking up a decent amount of experience. He's falling slightly behind, but he was critical in order to actually get that kill, so I think the time is worth it for them.
Stun on middle lane. They need the Hellfire Blast to follow up right now, and they got it too. Korok was prepping for this. He realized there's a regeneration rune inside the Medusa, but dropped the mana down low enough that even if she did get the shield off, it wouldn't be enough protection while up on top lane. For the first time, Swish won't get the fissure right, but Brax, the shackles will still go over the top of the seal, stopping the shackles, but he just burns to the Husker.
Yeah, what do you do there in that situation? Like, you can't decrepify yourself or else you're taking extra damage from the burning spears. And unfortunately, Skywrath Mage can't do anything because he's not really well known for amazing right click damage.
Curious be dying!
Yep. Chappie the Honorless Baboon.
Got him!
that's the name of the courier.
Wait.
Shout out to Chappie, the old Complexity manager.
Man, Complexity is a team name I have not heard in a while.
Yeah.
There's actually...
It's okay. Chappie might be coming back in the scene, apparently.
Oh, by the way, we actually have a team which is meant to be playing today, and I was not expecting this, and I don't know how they're actually playing in this regional qualifier. Uh-huh. But Terra Firma Esports will be our first... A Bullet versus Terra Firma Esports will be our first game of the MSI Beat It qualifiers coming up next. So we'll... it's a day of first. We'll have both the French as well as the rando team. Team Tinker playing today on here on our live stream. So,
rando.
Hope. Well, it really
correct term
is.
Would be international, maybe, but rando is much more fun to say.
They're like a that's not it. They're like a buffet, a little bit of everything, you know, and possibly also very, very contagious.
So. Checking out Infinity's build. Hasn't really done so much too much since he's had to play so passive in his lane with all the rotations. But way too sexy. He's obviously farmed up a lot. He's probably going to be going for an armlet. Armlet is a great item for a Huskar for several reasons, but I think one of the reasons that people don't think about is armor. Armor. Armor is important on a Huskar because he has a decent HP pool, but he's no armor whatsoever to speak of. And that just lends yourself to being gimped by physical damage, which is where that Face of the Void is going to be coming in later. Yeah.
Void's almost finished up his Mask of Madness as well. And we're only 7.5 minutes into the game with his Chrono. And with also the Vampiric Aura, it's allowing them to force out this tier 1 tower on the bottom lane. And there's no one from Power of Friendship that wants to come and stop this. Like Earthshaker with a fissure. At least Earthshaker's got some arcane boots. That's a nice thing for him. But like that just means a little bit of range fissure spam to slow down the attacks. But that's all.
Yeah, you can't blame anybody from Power of Friendship not waiting to go bottom because it's guaranteed kill.
Yeah.
Like whoever shows up. In fact, even
it's leap to Chrono to Hellfire Blast once the Chrono wears off and a Skywrath Mage to drop a nuke. Well, it's not even his big one either.
Once Snake King has his Mask of Madness, it's probably just a solo kill. Like, he probably doesn't need any extra help.
He's going to get it, though. You got a DD Nyx Assassin with Vendetta.
Yeah.
Like, that in itself is probably more scarier than anything else I'm seeing on this map. Now, he's going to use his Bottle Charge to get the Illusion Rune. TP up towards the top lane, so his DD's still remaining, but goes straight into Vendetta.
Ooh, where's the counter wards?
He's got to go into Vendetta before he gets in range of the Observer Ward, and he does so. Now, you're right. There's no Sentry Wards available. They haven't flagged the fact he's missing, and this is way two. I don't know if he'll die from one.
Wow.
He leaped in! Oh, you were going to pop way two. He's going to miss the stun. Where's the stun? There goes your stun. Prophet only bouncing through. Brax, so low in life. The Nether Ward is up and running. One last blast. It does not help him out here, but Korok still with the DD rune. How much damage has he got? Not enough. The orb actually turns. Oh, we're following. Okay, we probably shouldn't because bottom lane's getting a kill. I've lost the orb. Where's the orb? Where's the orb?
Toby, Snake King's gonna fall in the bottom lane.
Oh, no, he makes the line! No, he doesn't!
The arrow!
Arrow! Wow!
He has to backtrack it.
1437's getting body blocked up a little bit. But he'll walk himself away to safety.
Oh. Well, Medusa did something. He got a right click in.
That she did. She did. Obviously, ability's not important, it's just basic damage output. Yeah. 1437 and Brax are prepping themselves for the bottom lane. They're waiting for Degenerate just to walk himself basically past this line. The second he does that, they get the kill. But they'll see with the Observer Ward that he's backing up. They can't jump themselves over to attack. So yeah, they just have to force out the lane the old-fashioned way.
I have to say, I'm super impressed. Like, I've never heard of this player. His other name is MJW. I have no idea who he is. But I'm
MJW?
Impressed with his play so far.
Now, if you modify that a little bit, I'll be saying, oh, it's my jumpers. But yeah.
He's moving around the map a lot. He's got really good awareness. Like, for example, that last top engagement, he had a right-click on the pug and immediately kept moving and dodged the blast because of it. Like, his individual decision-making is on cue, and also his mechanics are pretty on point. Like, he's had some pretty good reactions so far.
Snaking's coming in. He's got Mask of Mana, Sleep Up, but no Chrono. He's going to look for a time lock hit, but with the... okay, Prophet... he sprouts, he ulties, and now they just back up. 1437 coming, a big brunt to that attack as well from the Wrath. But the Fissure unable to connect, and Brax will already just TP himself back out to safety. In fact, he comes up towards, Where did he go? He just went...
Snaking?
He did TP into the tier... Wait, what?
Who are you talking about?
No, I'm just screwing with myself right now.
Okay.
I can't help you there, Toby.
Chrono's on the top lane. It's going on Mario, and the Sky Wrath Mage did get the Mystic Flare off in time. I didn't think it's gonna actually reach him. And now looking for the kill over on Huskup. There's your first time lock. Your Mask of Madness is triggered again, so the high movement speed allows Stinging to keep up with this one. Concussive shot, they seal him up, and they will bring him down. Double kill coming in now for one, and Brax on the bottom lane. Netherward, the Cryptifier actually protecting himself. He's gonna go for the drain over at Infinium. The Doosa actually almost killing himself up there. Use Stone Gaze even at the same time, and to generate the slowest attack I've seen in a very long time from an Aegis Prophet to bring down a Death Ward. But the tier 1 tower is getting forced on the top lane, so even if you do see Power of Friendship force out the tier 1 tower in the bottom lane, it's just going to be a straight trade-off with the tier 1 tower.
Yeah, I think they could go for the fight because there's no Chrono as well as the Earthshaker already setting up.
Oh, double TPs. With no Chrono, where's way too going to jump to? Skywrath, he's really low on life with the Fidget connecting over on him. The Generate, they sealed up. But already Huskar has made the pounce while on bottom lane.
Mario,
Korok is currently
it.
Going. Ah, you got the Shackles! He got it in time. The problem is he's got no other hex, but the double stun will now come from Korok. He has Spy Carapace available. Yeah, she triggers it off, but not in time to where she get the return damage and stun into the Earthshaker. So now he's in a not enough damage. Korok will survive on 55 life points.
All right.
Mistakes were made.
Yeah, that was a misplay from Mr. Swish, but honestly, that it was pretty close. Like, it would take two extra hits from the Shadow Shaman. He just slightly overestimated the amount of damage he could do with an Echo Slam. Or maybe underestimated the high amount of armor the Nyx Assassin has, where the Shadow Shaman just can't do enough right-click damage. Dire's middle
tower is under attack. Right. The tier 1 tower was 9 up on top lane while all that was going on. Middle lane, however, is going to be completely pushed out. 1437 is basically the Night Watchman on the front lines, searching for anybody that comes in close.
Degenerate went for the Midas build, by the way, on the Nature's Prophet. We also have the Medusa, who is not going for the build that I was talking about earlier. It's a very early physical damage mixed in with some movement speed build. I think it's pretty strong on Medusa, but that's just me kind of theory crafting and going off of what Hani played with earlier. Infinity is going for a lot of stats, and this shouldn't really surprise too many people because of tanky heroes are good versus Faces Void because you can't really avoid getting caught in the Chronosphere sometimes. So if you can just naturally tank up and survive through to Chronosphere long enough to get off some abilities, I think it's good enough.
This is going to be a pointless gank right now from Power of Friendship, and they know it too. Like 1437 sitting there with Reincarnation. They got Mass Serpent Wards available, so they could actually kill him twice over because of that. And now, yeah, they didn't want the initiation, but they might just have to do it anyway to put his ulti on cooldown. And Skywrath's going to back up as well.
If they had the Fissure block there, I think the... I don't know, sometimes ganking a Wraith King can be worth it, because if you have such an overwhelming force against the Wraith King, and you're able to just kill him twice, not only do you kill that hero, but you also put his ultimate on cooldown. If it's a level 1 ult, it's on cooldown for so long. So it's almost a 5-minute cooldown. So it's just... sometimes the gank is worth it. If they had the Fissure block, they could have gone for it, but... Unfortunately, that missed, and that now means that Korok is going to have a lot of opportunities to find some extra pickoffs.
Well, Korok's looking for one, and Mario ships in the night.
Yeah, that was...
I'm really surprised that the Fog of War actually went like that, too. Now he'll see him in the middle lane, so Mario, if he backs up just a little bit too far... Korok's just like, screw it, I'm just going to go in. Stun, mana burn, vendetta hit, flinks himself away. The Prophet Ulti was bouncing around as well to try and slow it. Maybe getting some kind of collateral damage, but it's all too late. And they're just going to feed some trees in the middle lane. Prax one Pugna Blast will take care of that. Plus, he's going to save his mana to try and force out the mid-tier 2 tower.
So the Dusa is costing them, despite the fact that Huskar is, especially once he gets Armlet, he's a very aggressive hero, and they have a Furion for pushes. The Medusa is what's costing them all their map control, because she's just not a hero who can do much right now. So because of that, they're not actually able to be on the offensive and take any towers down. So they're losing out on gold, they're losing out on map control, and this is just going to continue to get worse and worse unless the Huskar can pull out some big plays. Because
even being on the defensive, man, Huskar can't do anything while Chrono is up. Because if he does it and his armor just keeps ticking out, he's going to lose his life points faster than he's going to be able to regenerate them up, because he can't toggle either, which means you got double sets of burst damage coming his way. And the tier 2 tower on the top lane, they can't fight that one out either, because where is your initiation coming from? Shadow Shaman kind of has to like come at point blank range to get a shackle off, which is only level 1, and the Hex is only level 1. It's like they want just straight burst damage with like the level 3 Aether Shock, and they're going to go for Roshan. Alright, so if you can't take fights, which I really don't feel they can, they just try and take Roshan. The problem is, their entire team is missing, and now Korok just walks himself in inside of Vendetta. There's no sentry wards, which means now Vendetta hit, stun, Chrono will come out from sneaking, and actually, while it might be completely wafted as far as not hitting on heroes, it kept out the Earthshaker as well as the rest of them. Now Huskar, also separated from the rest of his team, leaves himself into wards fogged, able to pick up a kill, snaking, trapped for the moment inside the shackles, Echo Slam as well, but he leaves himself away, the attack from the Shadow Shaman follows through. It gets the kill, it's a triple kill coming the way of Brax, and now Reincarnation will bring 1437 back to life again. Caught inside the Sprout, he's got one Hellfire Blast, and will just TP out. No point throwing it out, because he knew he could get himself away to safety. There were no stuns left. Earthshaker was basically... Actually, he had a Fissure, must still be on cooldown.
It was on cooldown, just a little bit too long. Whoa, Korra!
Yeah. Okay, that's aggressive.
Nobody hit him, so he just blinked away.
Yeah, well, and now he knows there's no mana on the Earthshaker, so again, there's no stun. So he's just freely walking in. He's got Vendetta as well. What are they going to do, mana drain him?
Well, he's got such high armor, the right clicks are just not enough to threaten him right away, so he just successfully stopped Roshan from being taken.
Yep.
And that, by the way, was a buyback from the Nyx Assassin to do that, but there was also a buyback from the Medusa in order to come back into the team fight.
Yeah. She did that so quickly, too.
Yeah.
It's a good thing they slid those tier 2 towers up so she could return to the fight quick. Alright, so Roshan's not being done right now, but Korok is on the hunt, and he found one. He found Infinity, and he found Mario, and he found a courier, and cannot make a decision. He came in range of the tower, however, so it is quite... Okay, courier. Okay, the sentry ward at the back line. He's managed to grab the creep wave up, and still managed to grab the creep wave up again. But Roshan's being done while they're worried about him. Fissure, nicely hit on snaking. The wards will come down. Roshan killed by the Radiant and picked up as well by the Faceless Void. Now the Chrono, they're draining the life out of Huskar. The armor's turned on, Medusa getting double stunned up with Mario, but it was the Mystic Flare mopping up a lot of his mana. One charge will now go, Korok by Carapace no longer protecting him. He'll go down alongside the Wraith King, while Snaking running himself away on that bottom lane. Really, while they may have taken Roshan, they might lose a little bit more here. The mid push is coming. They'll lose a tier 1 tower.
Yeah, finally. Finally, Power Friendship are going to be able to get themselves some sort of tower gold. That was what was seriously missing. It's why it seems so many people are so under-farmed. Dusa, as well as the Huskar, felt like they just didn't have any items, and it's because they don't have the tower gold to compare. Finally, they do get that mid tower. Now they're going to back up and farm. I can't say, like, I'm in total agreement with the Nature's Prophet build. But I've been impressed by most of his plays so far. He went for the Midas and then now a Dagon build, which is going to allow him to kill Fog.
Prophet. Evaporation. And actually some significant damage to the tier 1 tower because of it.
Maybe I'm actually okay with the Dagon. I mean, it's versus a Pugna, a Skywrath Mage. Both of those heroes are super squishy, and one of them is a core. On top of that, you have Decrepify on the side of Pugna, so he can't really use Decrepify to save his allies anymore, or else he just leaves them susceptible to that burst damage. It's not bad.
Top lane movement. 1437's going to go down. Snaking's going to come in, but he has no Chrono. 7 seconds on cooldown. And the stone gaze just slowed him up, so he had to turn himself around and he could not follow. Now he'll leap up. Chrono's available, but he's just a little bit too far away. Now he's got to do it. Degenerate. Okay, he could reach him through the Sprout. Actually, yeah.
Oh, they're going to chase down Snaking, though, with that jump from Way Too Sexy.
No backtrack, nothing. Brax trying to drain the life away, but Huskar sealed up. The Aegis Immortal will be going here. And Way Too on 2 life points. The Void will come back to life again. He could leap and try and go for a time lock, but It'll be very, very risky to do so. Especially considering Brax must TP back to base. But he can't. It's 30 seconds on cooldown. He's going to walk. But the bottom tower has been pushed out by Korok. We keep forgetting about this Nyx Assassin. Medusa doesn't. She comes down with Split Shot turned on, forcing him back. While up on top lane, looks like they're at it again. Mystic Flare almost mopping down the Earthshaker. But she fogged. Yep, there's way too. Double kill for him. And the Mana Serpent wards. Actually, they're attacking on. Okay, yeah. Okay, they're good. They're good.
So, way too sexy. Something very smart there. You have to time your life breaks sometimes really well. You don't want to be pulled back too far in clutch scenarios. This time, though, Prophet. He chased the Faceless Void.
There's a sentry ward. Korok's coming into a trap right now. They can see him. Hex as well as Shackles. And Dagon was already used for the initial burst damage. Man, now the US are actually losing this game right now.
They are. Just the last couple minutes, this game has turned down rather dramatically. And we do have mech up for the Pugna, so they may try and push some tier 2s now off of Chronosphere pickoffs, but and they do still have the late game. But in general, this is where Power Friendship kind of get a certain power spike just because of the Huskar. The Medusa obviously will get them a lot of late game. The Medusa is exceptionally strong versus the Faceless Void, though, because if you notice the last time when the Faceless Void tried to teleport to the top lane, they didn't know Chronosphere was on cooldown for just a couple seconds, but the immediate reaction from the Medusa is to pop the ultimate.
Yes.
And it's very tough for a Faceless Void to lay down Chronosphere, run past the Medusa, and not get stoned up in time. And even if he does, he's probably going to be just slowed up quite a bit. So the Medusa is actually a really good counter from Stone Gaze against the Chronosphere.
Yeah.
And it also includes all the allies who are outside of the Chronosphere helping to burst down some of the heroes that are inside. Because if they stare too long, they will also be stunned up.
I'm still wondering what the effect of Korok is meant to be on this game. Like, his net worth is actually quite low. At 5.7k with the 3 deaths to his name, obviously he's lost a hell of a lot here. Like, movement with Vendetta, there's no burst damage to follow up apart from a blink deck. Now he's going to be found out. 3 heroes just jump on him. NASA wants as well, and they caught Brax also very close to this. Dagon attack, and Brax can't drain in time. Skyrath, however, trying to bring down the generator, and he will be successful. So it's a 2-for-1 trade-off here. The offlane, technically your 2 cores. And 1437 is also okay. He's going to realize the fact that Mario just warded up then. But at the same time, you've got Infinity taking the tier 1 tower in the bottom lane. It's a huge injection of money and experience coming the way at the Dire side. And if this continues to happen, now the US might find themselves very quickly out of I-League.
Yes, the Huskar is so damn scary right now because he's got armor to protect himself from the Faceless Void. He's got a mass amount of strength between the Ogre Club plus the armlet being turned on, and he's now got the sustain offered to him from Helm of Dominator, which is super important because it means he can actually stand up against the Faceless Void when he's gone on. And once the Chronosphere fades, Way Too Sexy can turn onto the Faceless Void and be able to keep himself alive with the mass attack speed he'll have at low health and the sustain offered to him from Helm of Dominator.
Hey, it's smart. I know I was laughing about it because these heroes are just very, very rarely played, but it looks like Power of Friendship are making him work. Mm-hmm. They've got to keep him working, though. Like, and I think the other thing is the fact they keep getting more and more openings. The fact that Korok got caught out by a Sentry Ward up on top, he gets caught out catching out the bottom rune. This is buying them a lot of space to move around.
Yeah.
Even Mario, he's getting very close to his level 2 ultimate. In fact, sorry, he already has his level 2 ultimate. What am I saying? So he's got that one. The Urshik's managed to find his Blink Dagger. These supports are going to do some serious work, and these supports are meant to be food for Korok. He's meant to walk around the map, snipe them out, move on to the next target. But yeah, it's just not happening, and now he's having to build into a 4-staff as well. This isn't the killer Nyx Assassin we're used to, not when you run him as a core.
The point of the Nyx Assassin is to be able to create a lot of room, right? He's strong versus some of those squishy heroes you were talking about. He's an excellent pickoff in that regard, but he was also supposed to create a lot of room for Navi US, whether that was allowing them to actually take down towers or just to give the Void more room to farm up. Unfortunately, with the last pick of the Medusa, it means that you don't necessarily have the late game intact. because you might be creating room, you might be stalling this game out, but you're also stalling the game out for a Medusa as well.
Mm-hmm. Man, these illusions are being a real nuisance right now, but the tier 2 tower is about to go down. Two towers being destroyed off, the Fission will fly. But there's no real, like, follow-up going to come into this one. Earthshaker, he's got his blink, and they found one. They found the Pugnaro from the side, but Mario is going to get caught out in the Mystic Flare. Now, the Cripify and TP out, Echo Slam from the Earthshaker. That's the way to cancel, and Brax will die now. They at least got the ES ulti down. It's a one-for-one trade-off with two tier 2 towers going the way of Na'Vi US for what other trade? Like, the tier 1 town looks like it died on the top lane. But that's it.
Yeah, BKB was just picked up by Snake King, so they got a little additional out of that as well. But it looks like 1437 is going to... They realize this game is going to be going late. They couldn't really utilize the Pugna well enough. They didn't have enough control over the early to mid game that they could just take down all the tier 2s and go uphill nice and early on an over-farmed Void. So instead, what they're going to be falling back on is late game. I talked about the problem with that because Medusa is obviously very strong late game carry. So to hedge their bets, they're also making 1437 turn into a semi carry. He already has his Midas as well as an Armlet. Yeah. He's actually got another 1900 gold on top of that as well.
Not too shabby at all. Lines being drawn from Na'Vi US. Head up towards the top lane. Try and find a pick off somewhere.
So I kind of expected Way Too Sexy to go for a... Well, hold on.
Yeah,
gonna get it.
Watch the top lane, man. Korok's coming in again. The Sentry Ward is being dropped off. So Korok's aggressive movement getting flagged again. The warning has been like perfect timing coming out from Power of Friendship.
They've done an excellent job so far. I mean, they've grouped up a lot. And it may have cost them some farm here and there, but it's much better than being snowballed against by Nyx Assassin. So, Way Too Sexy went for a full SNY. I was almost expecting a Halberd. Evasion obviously doesn't help you against a Faceless Void, but the disarm is really good. Remember what we were talking about earlier last game? You should always get off your blink. You should always get off your disarm as well when a Faceless Void jumps in. So I think it's actually pretty legit, but... Way Too Sexy went for the more, not passive, but you don't have to do anything with an SMY.
Void, jump up. Krono's going to catch out too right now. They nuke down the Shadow Shaman, and then we'll move over to Medusa, and wow, she died quickly. With no shield to protect. Died insanely fast, and this isn't possibly the worst timing as well. There's an Alpha Wolf, which is controlled up by the Helm of the Dominator. It's just sitting in there watching Roshan. Now, that one belongs to... That's
Way Too Sexy.
Yeah, it's Way Too Sexy. So he knows that Roshan is up and running. But at the same time, without the Medusa and without the Shadow Shaman, I don't know if they can actually contest Roshan.
He's going to go for a kill.
But okay, why? This makes no sense. You're going to get critted up. The TP out by 1437. He may not even lose his ultimate. Actually, he does.
Wait, he died.
No!
Oh, wow!
He actually TP'd himself back, but he dragged him back to the bottom lane. Now...
That should not happen.
No, it shouldn't, because his body actually legitimately ended back out, back at base.
Yeah.
I followed him the entire way.
Yeah, you click on the Wraith King. He was inside the fountain.
Yeah.
But his tombstone was where his TP used to be. That's odd.
That has happened in the past, though, where you take the final point of damage in the lane, but your body will still be dragged home by the TP scroll.
Yeah, there's currently a video going around where in a pub, a lich bought back instantly and ended up going right back to where he died.
Yeah, I saw that one, but that was because toss animation.
Yeah.
Because it says, like, you toss you up in the air, but it says you will end up at this point when you land. So that's what it's all about. Now, Way Too, with an Alpha Wolf bonus damage, he just ripped through Roshan.
Oh, yeah, man. Huskar, low health.
Look at him go. Guy's a machine.
Now, when I said earlier, it was probably an overestimation in general, but when I said earlier, like, 30% of your damage is physical, that applies to, like, the early game, the first 20 minutes for a Huskar. Now, a Huskar is a big physical damage threat because he's finally getting some strength items, and when he does get low enough on his attack speed, he's laying out so many attacks in a row. And if he actually has the wolf, Alpha Wolf behind him, I think he can actually win a straight 1v1 up against Faceless Void, which is tough to say. Not many, many heroes. There are very, very few heroes that actually can make that kind of call. But Huskar might be able to with the right inner vitality.
As long as he doesn't have to fight inside of a Chrono, I think he's also quite good there too. Phases 4 just got a nice injection of money, and a full Mjolnir is over on Snaking. As well as 964 gold. And he's got a 10 second BKB with Mana Serpent Wards on the bottom. This is the time, but he just TP'd back to base. He can't come out to this tier 2 tower, so there's no point. There's no point coming forward. The BKB also wasn't up on the Pugna until just now. And they're running out. Look what Kurok has been forced to. He's getting sick of getting caught out. He has to walk around with a gem and try and do some dewarding. Unfortunately, Veeam is going to find this ward like 30 seconds before it's going to expire, so it's already done most of the work. He's missed the regeneration rune up on top river too.
So we haven't seen too many professional Huskars.
Oh, he missed it and Way Too is going to take it.
For obvious reasons. But I'm interested to see what Way Too Sexy's next build is. Does he go for a heart here? Well, you and just max out his survivability and also increases his damage?
Well, why would you go for heart when you could probably just pick up a Satanic and combine them up with your Helm and Dominator? You still get your strength you're searching for. And it's going to give you your survivability during the fight. The only thing I would be concerned about for him will be having something like a BKB. Like, Chrono is still going to be a problem for you, but you need to have some kind of extra immunity. Yeah. Your damage output's already going to come from your hero when you drop low.
Yeah, Satanic probably makes a bit more sense than a heart, but the reason I said heart was just because of the fact that he needs to make sure he isn't bursted down inside of the Chronosphere. In which case, heart gives you a little bit of extra strength. But
heart
Satanic
also probably
makes
means
more
you can just
sense.
Keep your armlet on the entire time, too. Yeah. So
I would say armor is the
Way
best
too.
Bet for
gonna
him.
Gonna get jump dumped, never got his armlet off, and he's gonna take a lot of damage because there's Hellfire Blast. Well, meanwhile, Snaking gonna get picked off, but Way Too tries to turn around and fight this one. 1-4-3-7. Remember, Way Too has still got Aegis the Immortal. 1-4-3-7, of course, has Reincarnation. So he's also trying to armlet toggle out this one. Mystic Flare to be dropped. Prophet's gonna try and come in to help him out. But it's already a little bit too late. Wraith King's low on life, but in comes Infinity. They'll bring down the Wraith King, but that's just triggered off his ultimate. Slowing down the heroes, I realize it generates in the tree line. Mana style. And I'm able to dodge out the stun. But now he's in real trouble. Hellfire Blast coming back off cooldown. And while with the rest of the team around him, he will drop. Meanwhile, Void, he died down here next to the Dire Observer Ward. So just a little bit up towards the tree line. So it was still a heavy trade off there. But Navi US coming out on top because they burnt the Aegis.
Oh yeah, absolutely. That was Way Too Sexy being too far forward, being overconfident about Huskar's strength right now, and then the overcommitment from the rest of Power Friendship in trying to actually help out the Huskar. They should have just given him up and split pushed where they could. But hard to say. Assault Cuirass finished up. 1-4-3-7, man. This guy has turned into a full carry mode with a big luxury item like that. He's super scary. Way Too Sexy picked up a Hyperstone. I said armor would probably make the most sense for him, so I'm going to say Assault Cuirass for that.
Did you touch on Snaking?
I did not.
With the quarterstaff he's currently walking around with. Now, I would ask the question, is this refresher for double chrono, or are we looking at like just an item which you'll convert into butterfly later on?
Yeah,
Because I don't see him building an Orchid up against this lineup.
No, that's got to be Butterfly. Even though Refresher is really good on Faceless Void, and it was probably what from last game that Ring of Health was probably going to be going into would be a Refresher.
True.
It's a really
weird way to start it, though.
Yeah, it makes more sense. The item pickup makes more sense now. But I would say, no, I don't think you should be going Refresher. If you go Refresher, you should have an Aghanim's first. In my opinion, to make the most out of that extra ultimate. So I would say 100% this should be a Butterfly.
All right.
I mean, he's already going for a damage dealing build anyway. It makes sense to continue on that thought process.
4-man smoke movement now from Navi US. So they come in towards the middle lane. There's only fake deuces there, but they're running him towards the top lane. And Korok is the man who's going to get scouted out straight away. Someone walking around with some kind of detection. It's the gem over on the Earthshaker. That's how they saw Korok. But now Way Too. He's out here by himself with, I hate to say, man, but your detection is sitting a little bit further back next to the tower. So he's got to be careful. With a 4-man smoke movement up, they're running up the lane, and now, okay, there's two heroes, the two cores that could easily go down. Void has Chrono. He can catch three heroes right now in the Earthshaker. He blinked himself away, but the Infinity going to get completely nuked down. The drain's already over on Way Too Sexy. Sneaking, trigger the BKB, but Massim was way leaping in even deeper to evaporate that Shadow Shaman. And 1437, there's Blast. Wave 2 is being held back. There's no creep wave here for Na'Vi US. So they're not going to force this in towards the tower. This was a pure kill mission only.
So it is going to be a refresher for Faceless Void.
Yeah, this is the way I would have seen you build the refresher before. Instead of getting the Ring of Health,
yeah,
you'd actually get the Oblivion Staff first.
Yeah, Oblivion Staff. Much better. But
so, okay. I mean, refresher is still really strong for Faceless Void. He doesn't necessarily have to focus on damage because 1437 is doing so much for him right now.
He just walked past the Earthshaker. Earthshaker will blink down. He does still have Echo Slam available. If he threw it out right now, we'd actually have the kill. He's waiting it four staff away. And now Degenerate's going to maybe even die. The orb wasn't thrown out, though. And Korok into Vendetta. He wants him dead. Korok, blink, blink.
Korok, why? Korok, why didn't you just run, buddy? He like, Vendetta'd away. He blinked a billion times.
He wanted the pickoff. He really wanted that Earthshaker's gem gone so he could freely move, but now he's basically given Earthshaker a gem for each eye. While Snaking is going to solo kill Mario. The chrono committal is high. The fissure will go, but he's still got time walk away, so even the four staff up to a total stomp wouldn't be successful. But up on top lane, Brax, Dagon attack, Huskar leap in, but Brax able to TP back out in time. He triggered the mech just in case the burn would be enough to kill him off, even in the protection healing of the well.
Mystic Snake is going to follow him, though, I think.
I was waiting, in fact, for the Huskar to follow him if you got the timing wrong. Because that does still work, doesn't it? They know they patched a couple of the global repositioners.
I don't think you should... No, I don't think Huskar follows that anymore. I think that was fixed.
Okay.
So no more global jumps. Any sort of leaps, blink daggers, any of those sort of things, Huskar will still follow, but straight up teleports are a bit too much. Bit too much for him to handle. Or at least I hope. I hope that's been fixed by now.
And Nature's Prophet is gone for what is normally considered a pub troll build. Because there's no blink dagger, there's no maelstroms to force anything out, it's just E-Blade with massive level Dagon. So it's five level Dagon as well as E-Blade. So that's basically a guaranteed kill. Actually, I want to say guaranteed kill over on the Skywrath Mage. Initially, I was like, maybe it could even be on the Wraith King, but really, Wraith King's gotten really, really farmed.
Yeah.
So probably not. But Pugna, definitely. That's an instant kill.
Yeah, if he doesn't get off his mech or BKB in time, it's just 1-2 before he can react. He's probably going to die.
But then again, like, he's going to have time to do it because you don't have any kind of repositioning abilities coming out from Degenerate or items to help him with that. He's got phase boost to run himself in, and that is all.
Basher now picked up by 1437. He's going to be picking up an Abyssal to go with his high amount of attack speed from Assault Kuras. So he is going to be a Bash Lord now. Another good counter versus the Huskar. So they now have two different heroes that are exceptionally strong versus Huskar, which is where the Medusa needs to start taking over. Unfortunately, it is not 70 minutes yet, so Infinity still needs his team to draw this out for at least another 30.
Just make it sound so easy.
Yeah. The 70-minute Medusa, man. It is real.
You'll get there. You'll get there. Now, way two, jump on middle lane. They go on 1437. But remember, 1437 is the bait. The chrono will go on way too sexy. Well, okay, Snake, he's going to walk around the fissure to lock him. Where's the hit? There's your hit. Snaking actually got stone gazed up for the moment. The Degenerate, though, caught out by Korok. So it's going to be a 2-for-1 trade off here with the Skywrath Mage going down. And Wraithing still hasn't died yet. Now, Korok jumping in. He wants his, what, Alpha Wolf? While Snaking, he wants the bigger prize. It's Mario over on the side. And Infinity's already back up and living again. I should say that because he didn't die.
Time to go uphill.
Will I have enough? I don't know if they really do have enough. Like, Mystic Snake's going to cause them some problems here. But there's no chrono. 30 seconds still on cooldown for it. But the Pugna Blast is actually helping them. Like, you kind of forget about that one. Just how much the blast will bring down the tower. So Brax just waits out the last bit of the fortification. Throws it out, there goes the tower. And they can bring down two sets of brackets here, because the blast obviously going to catch out two targets. Mass Open Wars from Mario, he might consider using this, but Korok jumps up. Mana Burn, attack with Vendetta, sneaking, also leads up. Oh, yo, gem. Gem, there's free money.
Yeah, nobody wants to drop anything for it, apparently.
There's no slots available, so Mario's sweet. I'll take that, bought back, got my own gem back. But the bottom rice goes down, and Roshan's alive again, too. And the courier just picked up the Perseverance for snaking, and you got a Void Stone also for Korok.
Yeah, and it will also be picking up the Abyssal for 1437 here in a short amount of time. Because he's got 4,800 gold on him, casually.
Fun choice of items for Korok to actually go in for a Yule Scepter here.
I like it quite a bit versus... any disables would be helpful right now. You would prefer Scythe of Ice, but Yule Scepter is like the cheap man's scythe at this point. Protect him up against the Huskar quite a bit. Or other heroes, potentially.
Now how we're thinking, like, Navi US could be losing this? Sorry, just brought up the crafts.
Yeah.
It's pretty high. And if this Roshan fight goes really badly for them, they're in even more trouble. And you see Korok running in. Now the ward prep. Oh, sneaking, sorry, trigger PKB.
Well, that's a good start for Power of Friendship.
And they saw it too. The Observer Ward saw it trigger. It was actually this Observer Ward up on the hill, which is only just freshly planted, that's watching their movements and profit. As he's going to try and sprout inside the pip, they'll see 1437 starting off. It wasn't really the way he wanted to do that, though. He wanted a tree that was on the low ground to actually summon a tree in, so he had vision inside.
You still have the same issues, which is they need to go on 1437.
The support is soloing Roshan. They've got to go in, but you're going in on a reincarnation target. Now the Chrono, it caught the Earthshaker. Mass Serpent Ward's outside the pit. This will make a bit more of a choke point, but now Refresher into second Chrono. Mario will go down as well. Way 2 got nuked down by Mystic Flare. Roshan's still not dead just yet. Way 2, however, he will die here. Infinity, he'll take a fall. Four heroes on the sideline. Fidget going to buy a little bit of space, but the Mass Serpent Ward's are gone. Roshan's on the sideline, and they just call it.
Yeah.
GG is it. 41 minutes and 23 seconds. The Earthshaker dies just for very good measure. But this will keep Navi US alive in the Iron League qualifier, which will continue tomorrow with 13 EST. But do not turn off your live streams for the joinDOTA Red stream. We'll be coming back here in a moment to watch the new French teams play up against each other. And I'm saying French team, but I found out how they're able to play in the MSI beat it for this region. And it's because Matt is now in Lebanon. So because he's in Lebanon, they have two EUs that are allowed to play, which is Shox and Girol, but they're playing with Babar and Mongo, who are actually technically part of that region too. So that's how these guys are able to play in this regional qualifier.
Are they going to, like, are they allowed to like, change their roster later if they do end up qualifying?
I don't know.
That would be some...
Either way,
all right.
Either way, they're going to be playing up because, yes, tune into iLeague coverage tomorrow, 13 CEST, right here on joinDOTA Red for those guys who did find the live stream, even though they're not match tickers anywhere because it's the round of 64 for an open qualifier. So no match ticker in their right mind would ever put that one in. So the games will be continuing up every day, 13 CEST, right here on joinDOTA Red. We are keeping the Dota 2 content coming your way. But for now, we'll need a short break, and we'll be putting the live stream down and then back up again to come back for the MSI Beat It Challenge for the first time here on Twitch. We were over on Azuba before, but now we're here on Twitch. Stay tuned. We'll be back.